In this episode, I am back on the mic here in Bear Branch, Indiana, and it's good to be home. I'm just returning after 4 weeks on the road out west, starting in Arizona and working my way all the way up to the Swan Valley. We had a lot of good times hound hunting. You're going to hear all about that in this episode. You're also going to hear me rant about wolves a little bit and bring you up to speed on some things that are happening out west with the wolf population. So make sure you stay tuned for that part. You can find us on Facebook at Houndsman XP Podcast, and you can find us on Instagram at Houndsman_XP_podcast. Instagram and Facebook. So make sure you're going there, finding us, following us. We want to get those followers up. The other thing we are going to really double down on is sharing issues that you're facing across this country on our social media pages. Just today, we released a bill or a House resolution out of Iowa that deals with hounds and trespassing. So it was submitted to me by a listener just like you who is concerned about what's going on in his neighborhood. So join the fight and preserve, promote, and protect hound sport. One last thing, get involved in your local hound organizations, your state organization, national organization. We need all hands on deck right now to help secure the future of our freedoms to free cast hounds and enjoy this lifestyle as houndsmen. You can make a difference, and your help is needed now. So at the cost of a few Mountain Dews a month, few cups of coffee, a couple cans of chew, you can make a difference from where you're at. Without any further delay, enjoy this podcast. I am happy to be back. We've talked about this before, so you know, we've talked about that analogy, lock your wife in the and your dog in the trunk for 30 minutes and see who's happier to see you. And when I get home, my coon hunting boxer, Roxy, couldn't contain herself. She was overwhelmed at the fact I was home, and Carrie was pretty happy.
Well, that's good. Well, that's a win-win, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, yep.
Well, you know, that's a shout-out to Carrie. You know, she kind of gave you up for a whole month there and gave you your wings, so to speak, to get out there and do some things that all of us hounds people love to do. And shout out to Carrie.
Yeah, she was pretty tolerant of the whole thing and never had a cross word to say about it. And it was kind of multifaceted this whole trip. You know, we started in Arizona and then made some stops in Las Vegas for the SHOT Show and made a lot of good contacts for Houndsman XP at the SHOT Show, working with Freedom Hunters there. But Gary Robertson was at the show, and we ate dinner every night. And of course, our old buddy Calvin Redhouse and I were palling around. You probably saw some of that on social media. But, you know, so it was multifaceted. It wasn't just me heading out to go run my hounds different places. It was as much about getting exposure for the Houndsman XP brand and the houndsman lifestyle.
Well, yeah, and hats off to you for doing that, Chris. Something that I think I'm talking with Terry Walker, the publisher of Full Crime Magazine, that goes out to the SHOT Show each year, and we talked at the Grand American recently about possibility of me going out next year, and that's something I've always wanted to do. That, man, that thing is huge, isn't it?
There are 30 miles of booths. Think about that, 30 miles of booths in the SHOT Show. And what the SHOT Show is, it stands for Shooting, Hunting, Outdoor Trade Show. So every vendor of anything that has to do with shooting or hunting, if some that you've never even heard of are there, you know, up and coming companies. They've got a whole section of new products that you have to have the credentials even to get in, and they won't allow you to photograph any of that stuff. You know, Mossy Oak was there in full stride with their new lines. It is a culture all of its own, and it's only open to exhibitors or vendors. So it's not open to the general public. So it really is kind of an exclusive deal to get in the door and even see it, but then to be there interacting with Savage Arms, Ruger Arms, Leupold, Trigicon, Hornady, any name that you can think of that has to do with our hunting was there. Garmin had a beautiful booth set up. Our old buddy Mark Zepp was standing there working the floor. Houndsmen, hunters, all kinds of people that are interested in Garmin were just wearing those guys out. And the cool thing, so these companies actually bring this huge display. The big companies will bring their display that may take up, you know, half of a, like a 100 by 100 foot area. And they bring an office with them, and they are having meetings the whole time they're there. And if you can get your foot in the door to get in one of those offices, then you're doing something. So it's big business. It's big business.
No, no doubt. And it, to me, it's just great to know that the outdoor lifestyle, I guess we'd say, is that popular, is drawing that much attention from that many companies. We hear so much, Chris, about how there's a decline in hunting and hunters and all that, but apparently when you look at it from the commercial standpoint, it's still doing pretty well.
Yeah, and more than the past week, I mean, when you're on the road as much as I've been, you've got a lot of time to think and think about things you see. I really believe that we have seen that pendulum swing as far as it can swing for hunting. I think it is going to start swinging back. We've got a whole, I was really encouraged by the demographics at the SHOT Show. There were people of all ages, all persuasions that were there at that show. And they know what that SHOT, what SHOT stands for. It stands for Shooting, Hunting, Outdoor Trade Show. And nobody was offended about dead animals. Nobody was offended about, you know, guns laying on the table. There were more guns in that place and nobody got shot. So, you know, guns jumped off the table and ran around the place and conducted a mass shooting. You know, everybody that was there, excuse me.
I know you get all choked up about
this. Yeah, I do.
Because it's so close to your heart, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Okay, so now that I've got my emotions back in check and I'm collected, the point I was trying to make is there are several divides in hunting and our outdoor lifestyle. And we put up a lot of those barriers, but I was encouraged to see the younger people there that were looking for ways to get involved in the outdoor lifestyle. I mean, that's basically what it was, and it was encouraging.
Well, yeah, it is definitely. And as I, you know, a fairly new guy to Instagram, social media, having been a kind of a Facebook junkie for several years, I see a lot of young people exhibiting their photos and talking about the outdoors on Instagram. And I'm trying to get tuned into that sort of thing. But for an old dog like me, it's great to see that there are young people getting involved. And, you know, here on our local level in Florida, there's a big push through our state association here, especially the PKC Association, to conduct youth hunts on wildlife management areas to as a gateway to bring young hunters in to the hound sports, and at the same time to open those gates to all to hound hunters in some of the WMAs that are now closed to hound hunting. So at any rate, yeah, all good stuff, encouraging for sure.
Yeah, and we need every person. We can't afford to, you know, set ourselves up on this elitist pedestal and say, you know, the way you hunt is not welcome here. You know, I don't care if somebody is out there for no other purpose than providing organic meat for their table, I am glad to have them, you know, and just like your state organization down there, the Hoosier Tree Dog Alliance just got done with a, they'll have their banquet this weekend, tomorrow night, February 8th. It'll be over by the time this podcast comes out. But they just did a, they just finished up with their annual youth hunt at Crosley Fish and Wildlife Area, partnering with the DNR to get hunters in the woods, young hunters in the woods. And it doesn't matter if that person is not a dyed-in-the-wool hunter, or he doesn't hunt the way you do, or whatever. That's a kid that has been exposed to the positive side of hunting, and now he's got a face to put with that guy that he's, you know, that he's hearing all these horror stories about, and thinking, you know, I went hunting with those guys one time. I had a good time. I think this is wrong. I think what I'm being told here is wrong. So it's valuable on so many levels, and we just can't afford to, you know, be kicking anybody to the curb in this current climate with hunting and fishing.
That's right, Chris. I think that was proven with our Freedom Hunters event with Tanner Babb, and how that Tanner had never been exposed really to hound hunting, and you know, 1 week in the Navajo Nation, and he was ready to buy a hound dog pup, you know, and looking forward to bringing his son into the lifestyle. And so, yeah, definitely. You know, I thought about, too, about a recent podcast we did, the Q&A one with Nick Gilliland, and we talked about this thing of, you know, hunting groups saying, well, it's okay if you go along with us, but we don't want you to bring your dog. You know, we've got this fine-tuned pack here. We don't want anybody messing it up type thing. That kind of elitist attitude is very harmful to the hound sports. And clubs, whether it's a coon club, rabbit club, whatever, sometimes I think people tend to think, well, we don't want these guys to come in because they'll beat us. You know, their dogs will outperform our dogs. Those kind of feelings are really harmful to our sport. And we all need to be on our toes that we're not entertaining those kind of attitudes when it comes to bringing new people in.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree with that, but I'll play the devil's advocate a little bit. So remember our buddy, Randy Smith. You know, he talked about paying your dues and being a willing mentee, you know, willing to take advice from the mentor, the people that do have that sort of stuff. So if you are getting that kind of response from hunting groups, you know, maybe you need to roll up your sleeves and show that you're willing to pay your dues. You're willing to walk to that tree that doesn't have your dog on it, or help drag that bear out that you didn't shoot, or judge a cast that you don't have a dog in. You know,
oh yeah,
I think there's some value to that too. And I'll probably be, you know, maybe not the most popular point of view because it's old fashioned, but there's nothing in this world that's free. And if you want to be widely accepted, sometimes you got to pay some dues, and they see you're ready to work, and I think you'll gain that status within the sport.
Well, I agree, Chris, of course. And I think there's a lot to be said in our name, Houndsman XP, Extreme Performance. It does take people to the people that are successful in catching game or breeding dogs or whatever aspect of this hound sport or lifestyle that we choose to participate in, it's going to take a lot of dedication. It's going to take a lot of dues paying, as you say, to get to that level where we do gain the respect of our fellow hunters. So it's not like you get a participation trophy in this sport, yeah, or this lifestyle, as I'll correct myself once more. But yeah, I agree with you.
You know, not to, you know, totally kick what you said to the curb. That's not what I'm trying to do at all. I just think that, I'll give you an example, an analogy. Okay. I will see posts on social media of a guy with his kids out hunting, and they'll be sitting in a blind and say they're turkey hunting. And I've seen this actual post, you know, Dad takes the kid out there, 5 years old. The only thing Dad's thinking about is, if I can just get him a shot on a turkey, he'll be hooked for life. And then he pans over to his kid, and his kid's sitting there with an iPad playing some game on his iPad to keep him busy. You know, just for I don't get that mindset. You know, make that kid, if that kid's truly, when I was young, and I've done this, raised my kids this way, you've got to put in your dues. It's not always going to be about you and you being successful. You know, I can't wrap my mind around this deal where we think that we've got to set, it's not always a success. It's not always a success, and sometimes it's a lot of work. I've told my son, you know, when men endure hardships together, then they forge deep bonds. And some of those hardships are being cold, being miserable, but after it's all over, you look back at it and say, man, our bond's stronger now. And sometimes our newer hunters a lot of times have this expectation that they're, you know, they are getting that participation ribbon. I've got a dog box. I've got an antenna on my truck. I'm a bear hunter. Well, the guys that are real bear hunters don't always see it that way. And we got to have that realistic expectation too. But for anybody to sit back and say, you know, no, you can't participate, or we want to be elitist and we're scared to let new people, that's wrong too. I mean, we've got to find that happy medium on that.
Well, we do, but, and guys my age, you know, we were raised in this era where there was satisfaction in hard work. There was satisfaction in knowing that that big pile of gravel became a very small pile due to the sweat equity that we put into it. You know, I mean, that was the way I was raised. You know, did I want to get out there and hoe those long rows of corn in my dad's garden? Absolutely not. Would I have rather been playing baseball or all? But, you know, at the end of that row and to look back and see it all done, there was satisfaction in that. And I just wonder today if we're providing that kind of satisfaction to young people. You know, do we get, like you say, you know, to get out there and harvest that bear in a rough place, teamwork, bring it up out of that canyon, get it back to the vehicle so everybody can get a grip and grin shot with it.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a tremendous sense of accomplishment in that. And I'm afraid that by trying to make everything easy, we're actually depriving these youngsters of that privilege. Does that make sense, or is that just
no?
An old
I think
guy
so.
Talk?
You know, I think you know, when that kid, we need to celebrate that success, and somebody in that group, the leaders of the group, need to turn around to that 13-year-old kid that helped drag that bear out and say, man, you did a good job dragging that bear out. We couldn't have done that without you. You know,
exactly.
Thanks for packing, you know, carrying our pack out while we drug the bear out. You know, thanks for leading that dog out, and make them feel involved. And you're going to develop that desire in that young hunter or a 20-some-year-old hunter that's going to say, hey, I want to be a part of this. I can't wait for my chance, and I'm going to get there, but the chance wasn't today. So,
yeah, well, and I can't help but go here, and I know this is probably not going to be real popular with some people, but, you know, often what happens is, you know, the dogs get in there and they tree, and we take this kid in and we help him hold the gun and we help him make the shot, and we drag the bear out and we go through all the pain, the sweat and everything else. The kid, and then when it's time to take a picture, we go over and high five him and say, man, you did a great job today. You know, you got your bear. You
exactly.
Know? And
exactly.
This kid is like, oh, I did. Well, that was easy.
Yeah, that was easy. You know,
and I guess. But yeah, we want to do those things for the kids, but we also want them to be a part. And being part of the work and the effort and putting the time in and all that is all part of it. Yeah. And, And the rewards are greater when you do that. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, and this isn't just a preaching session for newbies or whatever. No. It's or the old timers. This applies across the board. I just came off of a 4-week trip where I was the guest everywhere I went. So right. Just be a good guest.
Well, that's what happens when you're famous, you know?
I forced myself on them. They didn't have any choice. But, you know, if I'm standing in the Rocky Mountains with Larry Anderson, my buddy from Montana, and, you know, he says, hey, you know, I don't think your dogs are going to be able to take this track. Let me turn one of my older dogs loose. You know, you gotta be wise. You gotta be smart enough to realize that this guy's got experience, and you just go with the flow and be a good guest, be gracious. You'll get your chance. So mm-hmm. I found that a lot, you know, everything from we're going to get into this whole Western tour. There are so many stories that I can't even, we could fill up 3 podcasts with it. So we'll get into that.
Well, you know, I think that the thing about this Western tour for me, which I only participated in the first week of it, you then went ahead and put 3 more weeks into it, was that it was a great time, but it was not particularly successful in terms of animals harvested or treed or caught, whichever term you want to use, but it was still a great time.
Oh, it was a blast. I mean, just being out there, I posted some stuff on social media during the trip of the good times we were having. One particular post I remember is when I was on the Red Rocks up there. Lauren took the picture of me standing on the edge of the rocks with Jazz, and we're overlooking this beautiful country. There are thousands of people that drive through the Navajo Nation. There are very few people that have seen it from the angle that we saw it while we were there. And That's the intrinsic value of it. You know, did we catch a mountain lion for Tanner on that trip, on that part of the trip? No, we didn't. We treed one beforehand, a day early. But just the intrinsic values of being there and being there with my hounds participating was very valuable. And it's a memory that can't be replaced. Yeah, a lot of times we measure by how much game's caught and how, but I'll tell you what, those I learned a lot, the dogs learned a lot, and I know we try to put value on that, and it's not the same as being able to post grip and grins and lions and trees and stuff like that. But the relationship I forged with Calvin Redhouse, it didn't matter whether you treat a lion every day. I mean, that's a solid relationship. Kevin Hall stopping in there. We didn't even turn a dog loose, and just spending time with Kevin and Nancy Hall of Dogs Are Treed. You know, that's a relationship that we'll continue to groom in the future. You know, the relationships I built at the SHOT Show, and then you go on up to Montana and what we did up there, the people I met, and the places I got to go and the things I got to see, and you can't take that lightly.
Well, you know, I guess I learned or developed that mindset at a very young age. And it's primarily due to my dad. My dad was never a houndsman that hunted particularly for the kill. It didn't matter if we were, you know, coon hunting, or if it was bear hunting or whatever, we fishing, whatever, it was the experience. And I guess I learned that early on, and there was something within me that would just when the fall of the year came, just to be able to take that gun out of the cabinet, smell that gun oil, gunpowder, and walk out there with those crisp leaves crunching underfoot, and that smell of the fall, those were all things that were just burrowed very deeply down into the center of me from a very young age. And the younger we are, the more we want to kill things. You know, I mean, we want to come home. I can remember the thrill of walking home for the first time with the weight of a squirrel in my hunting coat, you know, and reaching back there and feeling that squirrel and knowing that I had been successful. Yeah, that was a big rush. But for that same scenario, I've walked home after school many a time at dark with my shotgun over my shoulder and nothing in that game bag and happy as a pig in mud because I'd got to spend the afternoon out in the woods.
You weren't hoeing your dad's corn.
That's right. Well, I was going to have to do that before he got home on the weekend. That's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. That sounds like my planning as a kid, you know, it'd be like, well, I could run down to the creek and try to set a few traps and, or do this or do that. I think I've still got time to get the green beans weeded before dad gets home. So I've been there and done that, but you're exactly right. I mean, if you go strictly on game caught on this trip, I think vast majority of hunters would say the trip was a failure. We had bad weather. I mean, bad weather on the reservation. We had it in Montana. We had wolves that were covering us up. There were a lot of things that prohibited us from being successful. The lions that we did get on and we did turn loose on, we treed. So,
yep.
You know, it's you can't just measure if we just measure the success of our hunts on game on the ground or game in the trees, then that's pretty shallow.
Well, I think this breaks down to any area of the hound sport. If you're a coon hunter that goes to a night hunt, you're a beagler that goes to a field trial, or a squirrel hunter that hunts in competition or whatever, and you go with the attitude, if I don't win, I'm not going to have fun. I'm not going to have a good time. Then you're probably, chances are, at least 50% of the time, you're not going to have a good time. But if you go for the idea of being out there and participating and playing that game, if whatever it may be with your dogs, or if you're just out there, you know, on a pleasure hunt with your dogs by themselves, you know,
yeah.
It's all the experience. And it's really hard to explain that, I guess, to a new a hunter or a young hunter that maybe has focused on the idea of I've got to catch an animal in order to have a good time. Well, in this lifestyle, for me at least, and for my dad that taught me, you know, that was never the primary focus.
The most accomplished houndsman I know, Steve, whether it be, you can go to the, I've been to the big events, the big PKC events, big UKC events. I've hunted in the West with houndsmen, but the most accomplished hunters I know, you know, you see these houndsmen will come in after a cast and everybody wants to know, did you do any good? And they say, nope, I didn't have any, I got beat tonight. And they're not looking for ways to complain about somebody cheating them or, you know, you've got certain people that come in that every time they lose, they got cheated. And then you've got the accomplished hunters, houndsmen that come in and I got beat and they accept it. You know, you look at guys, we could name names, but we know who they are. It's just part of it. You're not going to be successful every night or every time you go. And I see the same thing on this Western hunt. You know, was I disappointed that we didn't tree more lions in the Swan Valley, which last year we went out there and treed 3 in 2 days or something crazy. And this year we treed 1 in 9 days of honey. And Larry and I still had a good time. We still knew that all those things were out of our control. We can't control the weather. Our dogs' feet were getting ground up by, it would get up to 40 to 50 degrees during the day, melt the top of the snow. Lions, bobcats, whatever, walk right over it. You don't have a visible track. If you do find a track and you turn loose on it, we had blood in the feet, the dogs' feet were actually bloody in the snow. So we knew we couldn't keep that up.
Sure.
And then you do get the snowfall and you're headed up the trail and you find these lion tracks you want to turn loose on and you go 20 more yards and you find a pack of five wolves. And I'm not talking little wolves. These are full grown Canadian gray wolves that have been forced introduction down the throats of our Western sportsmen. And I actually saw those wolves up on the mountain, 300 yards above us. They were standing there looking at us, and it was weird. When they realized that I was seeing them, when I locked those eyes with them, then boom, they took off running. So that's a whole topic. It's the wolf problem in the West.
Oh yeah, so, big time.
Yep.
Well, yeah. Well, that's it. I mean, if I were to take a young person under my wing today, I would be all about teaching that kid about the dogs, the sounds of their voices, the way that they are able to track and tree, and all of the things that go along with that, and the beautiful woods. That's why we go to Arkansas every year. It's never been about going out there to kill a lot of coons. It's always for my buddy Nubbin and me. It's just to get in those beautiful woods, to walk out there in those huge oak timber, in that huge oak timber, and it's like a cathedral. Mm-hmm. You know, it's an awesome experience. And to be able to relate that to a new person is what, you know, will actually hook them and keep them hooked, so to speak, for a lifetime, because it's not superficial. You know, it's not just about the catching of the game. And, you know, on our Freedom Hunters hunt, you know, you didn't mention here, but, you know, we got blindsided right out the gate there with the closing the areas that we intended to hunt.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Calvin was great. I mean, he took it on. He said, well, you know, we've got more areas to hunt. Let's go. You know, we had to drive. But I know he was disappointed, because he knew he'd done his homework. He had scouted the area out. He knew where there were some lions that we could run, but it didn't work out. But did that hinder us from having a great time? A lot of laughs.
Oh, yeah.
Trying to follow Ricky Bobby.
Yeah.
On those narrow trails.
Yep, no doubt.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and the same thing happened all the way up into the Swan. I mean, we broke stuff. We got trucks stuck. I got my truck stuck. Larry got his truck stuck. You know, it wasn't from a lack of trying, I can tell you that, and it wasn't from a lack of dog power either, because Larry Anderson's got one of the finest packs of blue ticks that big game hounds that you're going to find anywhere. So, and then my potlickers were doing what they could to support that. So,
well, you know, I enjoyed very much the videos you posted, you know, and when I saw you guys winching the truck out of the ditch and all that stuff. And, you know, we got into that a little bit with, deal out there with Shorty Gorham in South Texas, you know, after a rain, you know, and we thought we were going to be back in that Texas ranch country for quite a while. And we weren't, but able to get it out. But
we got that Ford F-250 out of there. I thought it was going to come apart. That was a testament to the toughness of a Ford F-250 that day. That's for sure. That whole frame was shaking when we backed off that road and got stuck over in the ditch. You know, we threw those branches and logs and everything we could find in there, and the whole cab and everything was shaking. I thought, we're still going to be walking, you know, hitching a ride on an oil truck out of here or something.
Well, that's the thing about a four-wheel drive. It'll just get you stuck in worse places than you could with a two-wheel drive, that's for sure. Man, I remember those old days, you know, jacking the truck up. It's all high-centered, breaking limbs and stuff and sticking them under the wheels to try to build it up. And, you know, we didn't have winches and all this fancy equipment back in the day. You know, we might have had a manual come along or something if we could find something to hook it to. But But that's all part of the experience of this hound hunting game, you know. And you're not going to be a metrosexual guy in skinny jeans on in Manhattan out there doing what we're doing. But we're having a ball doing it, and I would dare say a lot more fun than that guy. So
yeah, you know, you look at Instagram and the social media platforms, and you'll see hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people that have been successful on a lion hunt. And a lot of them aren't houndsmen. You know, they went there, they paid money, they flew in, they had somebody scouting those lions. You know, they had all those things already lined up for them. All they had to be able to do is walk to the tree, pull a trigger, and get their picture taken. Everything else was taken care of for them.
Right.
You know, the
right.
houndsmen are the guys that are out there, you know, winching trucks out and fixing tracks on buggies and, you know, one thing after another, feeding dogs, you know, all those things go into it. So there was a lot of good experience and things that we did that, you know, I got to live in the West for a month and see the good and the bad.
I didn't get to get up into the Rockies in Montana like you did or in Utah, but I did certainly enjoy the Navajo Nation and those views from any direction, you know, every day, a different view, a different Kodak moment, so to speak. But and that's, you know, Chris, that's this lifestyle that we've chosen for ourselves, or maybe it chose us. I think in my experience, it seems like that I was captivated by hounds and hunting from my very earliest memories. You know, my dad, as I said before, you know, he was a guy many times would walk up to a coon tree and not even look up the tree. Just, you know, encourage the dogs and enjoying the activity of being there. And a guy that rarely carried a weapon with him on a bear hunt. Mainly we handled the dogs, you know. We knew if we were handling the dogs and we got a track as we walked from one ridge to another, those dogs were going to blow out of there and weren't going to get to hear much of the race. And somebody else was going to get to the tree and see the bear and maybe harvest the bear. And we knew all that, but still we chose to go with the hounds.
Yeah.
You know,
You know, the unit we hunted in the Swan Valley there, that's a draw unit. I didn't draw a tag for that. I just had a general mountain lion hunting license. So we were hunting that unit with the full expectation that nobody in our party could even pull a trigger on a mountain lion or a bobcat. The quota was already closed on bobcats. So, you know, you talk about hauling a truckload of hounds for 4 weeks across the West with the full expectation that I'm never going to shoot anything. My wife looks at me and she's like, you know, I sent her pictures home of the lions we treat. She's like, did you shoot it? And I was like, no. And why wouldn't you shoot it? Well, for one thing, it's illegal. But for the other thing, you know, for the other reason is, I'm not there to kill lions. I'm not against it, I'm not opposed to it, but I'm there to work dogs. I'm there to get experience. I'm, you know, those sort of things, share good times. So that's what it was about.
Yeah, absolutely it is. And, you know, I have to explain that too from time to time, you know, to Ella about the fact that we had a great hunt. We didn't maybe catch any game. You know, that has always been the thrill of the hounds, the sound of the chase, watching the dogs work, seeing how well they were able to work that bad track. I enjoyed very much hunting with Calvin, watching his dogs each day. I've never experienced the dry ground lion hunting type thing, and we were doing some of that out there. We had snow at higher elevations, as you remember, but a lot of the time, you know, the dogs were attempting to trail those tracks on dry ground. In fact, I think the lion that you guys treed the day earlier, didn't you? Wasn't that a dry ground track?
Yeah, the whole thing was dry ground. And, you know, we ended up being able to tree that line. But the snowpack was so thin up in Montana that even some of that was would be considered dry ground. There wasn't any snow up there to speak of. There, the bases of the trees and stuff all had 15-foot circles around them where the snow had melted off. There was still snow on the high peaks and stuff like that, and snow on the trails. You could have chained up and got up there in a truck, a lot of them. You saw the video of where we tried to do that one time and trying to turn around and high-centered that Toyota. And somebody made a comment, if you would have chained all fours, you would have made it. Well, not when you're sitting on the frame. You know, it goes right down. It dug through the snowpack, and there wasn't any coming out of there without a winch. I don't care if what you would have done prior to that. So that's all part of it. But so some of the things that I did get to do that were crazy. I mean, you talk about moving an Indiana hillbilly out of his comfort zone. So we decided to we'd been hunting for a week. We'd treed one lion. We had rain moving in. We had high winds coming in. And so Larry wanted to run over to Idaho and look at some areas that for future bear hunting and stuff. And I'm thinking, yeah, we got a few days, let's roll. And I drove, and going over Lolo Pass from Missoula into Kuskokwim, Idaho is an experience on dry ground. And it was a real experience because they had snow up high. And here I am white knuckling this steering wheel all the way over that pass. And I looked at my phone at one time. I think that pass is at 9,300 feet. But then you drop into the Idaho side, and it's 100 miles of the Frank Church Wilderness running right next to the Lashkar River, all the way down through there, Lakshaw River, all the way down through there, the same route that Lewis and Clark took. And just steep mountains going up both sides of this Lakshaw all the way down through there. And it was just amazing, especially when you would stop and you would read the placards on the side of the road that's the same route that Lewis and Clark took in 1806. So there was no pavement. There were no guardrails. You know, it was just 26, 27 guys that got a call from the president of the United States and said, hey, Meriwether Lewis, what do you think about leading an expedition into this country? We have no idea what's there. We don't know if you're going to make it. We don't know if you're going to live or not. We'll supply you everything you need to a certain point, and then you're on your own. Just taking that all into consideration and seeing that country where they came through and stuff. I mean, it is a humbling experience and really makes you question how tough you really are.
No, absolutely. I just recently, it's interesting you say that, I watch a program, I think maybe it's on History Channel, but I'm not sure, but it's a new show that aired this year about the River of No Return and the Salmon River and some of that area there that you're talking about in the Frank. Where, you know, Lewis and Clark at one point, I think they wrote, or one of them, maybe it was it Lewis that was there, or were they both together at that point?
I didn't get that. I'm going to have to do some research. It really sparked my interest to do more history checking on that. I'm vaguely familiar with it, but I don't know.
Yeah.
I know they were about starved to death right there. They about starved to death in that country, and you'd think being there, you know, the game would be plentiful. And if it hadn't have been for Sacagawea hooking up with them and guiding them through there, they probably would have died right there in that wilderness.
Yeah, I really enjoyed at the, what was it, the bicentennial or whatever of the Lewis and Clark expedition, all the programming that was out there and the materials. And I read a couple of books about it and all. And I still just, you know, marvel at the tenacity of those guys and able to do what they did, you know, and
Yeah.
Because it's rough in a four-wheel drive, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. So, you know, you get the Idaho side, and the road was pretty good. Montana, their road budget must not be what Idaho's is, or I don't know why, but it seemed like as soon as we hit the state line, then the roads cleared off. But still, those winding roads, those downgrades, stuff like that. Then we go on over to Grangeville. We spend some time there, and we go up into this country up by Orofino, Idaho, and dropping into the Clearwater. And you'd be surprised. I was surprised. So we get north of Grangeville there, and it's this big, beautiful agricultural area. It's rolling, but it really doesn't look a whole lot different than what I would see in northern Indiana here. And amazing country, and I'm just like, wow, I would have never guessed that this was here. And the state road turns into a black cinder road, and we keep going, and it's like, are we on the right road? Yeah, we're on the right road, just keep going. All of a sudden, this sucker drops off into this canyon, and I'm on a black cinder road now, and I think I've got hills and driving's treacherous here in Bear Branch, Indiana. I'm telling you what. I dropped over that ridge into that canyon, and to one side of my truck, and this road's probably, you know, 15 feet wide. Mm. One side of my truck.
Plenty of room.
Oh, all kinds of room. And don't mind that. Don't even pay attention to those, you know, where the snow's been melting off of the sheer rock cliffs to your passenger side and running off the 1500 foot drop on your driver's side. You know, don't mind those icy spots that froze all night. And I looked at Larry and I was just like, I'm not used to this kind of driving, you know? And he's just laughing. He's like, you'll make it, you'll be fine. But talk about bringing me out of my comfort zone a lot right then. I was just like, holy crap. I hope I don't meet anybody on this road. I'm going to have rock scratches all the way down the passenger side, 'cause I'm getting up next to that rock wall right there. And, it was crazy. It was crazy. And you know what? This is the most amazing thing. I decided right there that 50 years old, I don't know that I'm tough enough to hunt in that area. I really don't. I mean, that is a whole nother, that is a whole different experience. And we're passing trucks with dog boxes that are hunting that area. So my hat goes off to anybody that's hunting with a hound in the Frank Church or up along the Clearwater. Those are some tough individuals that are pursuing their hounds in that country. It's amazing.
No doubt. No doubt. I get that feeling, having been a plot man for many, many years. And when I go to the Smoky Mountain region, and I know that those mountains the mountains back east here are nothing compared to the Rockies, but they are, you know, some of those peaks are up around 6,000 or so, but it's very, very steep, very rocky, very rugged. And I think about the day that those mountaineer hunters hunted that all on foot. They didn't have, you couldn't even take a mule up those ridges, you
yeah.
know, I mean, it's,
yeah.
and how they hunted. And I read the stories of how they struck a bear and it went all the way over the, what they called Smoky Mountain, you know, the main, the main mountain up there. I think Clingman's Dome is over 6,000 feet and drop over into the Tennessee side. And then their dogs, somebody passes the word along, hand to mouth or whatever, that so-and-so has the dogs over on the other side. And what's there to do but walk over there and get them, you know?
Yeah.
And it just amazes me that what they were able to do.
Yeah, not taking anything away from the hunters in Appalachia. But, you know, you think of guys like Barry Tarleton of Houston Valley Plots that talks about the days when they would follow the hounds through the mountains and hunt bear off a foot before telemetry and radios and all that stuff. Their only option was to walk with the hounds. Well, somebody asked a question a few years ago on social media, where's the toughest place you ever hunted? And everybody thinks where they hunt's the toughest place. That country right there that I just came from, along the Clearwater and down the Lockshaw River, I mean, it is bad news. And it there are some terms that I could use to describe the type of men that hunt that area, but they're probably not appropriate for mixed audiences. You know, let's just say they probably leave tracks in the snow behind them. That's all I'm, you know, more than footprints. Holy cow.
I got you.
These, yeah. So going across this Lockshaw River, there are these bridges that go across there, and the outfitters will park their stock rigs down there. And these are big wooden bridges. I took some pictures, maybe some video of one of them. I don't know if I posted it yet. But as you look across the river, the only thing across from where you're standing on that road is a mountain that goes up. And we walked across there, and these outfitters and houndsmen are walking across that river and hitting that trail on the other side. But can you imagine riding a horse, leading five mules behind you, all strung together, and going into the Frank Church Wilderness on a thing that's no wider than the trail is literally no wider than the largest laptop computer, no wider than that. And they're riding up into that country. And that's just some tough stuff right there.
Well, it's a whole different perspective on things. You know, we see the pictures, we sit back here and we read the stories in outdoor magazines. It's just like when I went up in Sunlight Basin there on the east side of Yellowstone in Wyoming, and looking at some of that country where my friend Dean Carroll's son, Dalen, was going to be guiding sheep hunters up in that country. And I'm just, you know, it's those days, if I was ever able to do that, and I think there may have been some days back.
Oh, sure.
When I was a young man, I could have handled that okay, but not today.
Yeah.
And guess what? I don't want to.
Yeah.
Oh, I guess that's not totally true. I realized this on our trip out to the Navajo Nation that, you know, there were some times there where, you know, I had to stay back and kind of be an observer and listen on the radio. And that goes against the grain with me, but I'm still out there doing what I can do. And that's, and I intend to do that as long as I can.
Sure. Yep. And it's possible, because we actually saw along the Lockshaw there, we passed two or three rigs of trucks with hounds in them. So those guys are hunting it, and it's a tough place to make a living, I can tell you that. So I want to rant about wolves a little bit.
Go.
You think I can rant about wolves for a few minutes?
Absolutely. You can. This is your show. You can do whatever you want.
You know, I couldn't help but think while I was out there, you know, we watch the news and we think about all of the things that are being forced down our throats, the things that we love to do, the freedoms that are being attacked. And I looked at this wolf track and I'm thinking, this is a forced introduction of a non-native species to the Rocky Mountain that's decimating the elk herds. Those wolves follow those elk herds. When the elk herds go low, the wolves go low. All those deer, all those elk, everything, every ungulate on the landscape out there is sleeping with one eye open every night and trying to make a living with those wolves. But I thought, you know, and now this wolf track is interfering with my lifestyle. I cannot turn my hound loose on this prime lion track because of these Canadian gray wolves that were forced down our throat by the liberal left that thinks that is the answer to wildlife management. You know, we are kicking the most effective model for wildlife conservation, the North American model for wildlife conservation. There is nothing in the history of the world that has shown the success of that particular model. And then we introduce this non-native species into this ecosystem, and we're just watching it degrade and crumble to the point where The wildlife numbers are down. The herd numbers are down on our elk and our deer out there. And it's now it's affecting my ability to turn my hound loose. So it got pretty personal for me. And thinking about, you know, what is it going to take, and what's this, where's it going to stop?
Well, I think most people would think that it's going to stop when these wolves are in the subdivisions and they're, you know, snacking on Fluffy Dog and they're snatching kids out of their strollers and it sounds extreme, but it's certainly not out of the realm of possibility. And then we see Colorado. Now, have they actually reintroduced the wolf yet, or are they just talking about it in Colorado?
Well, one thing, and I'll just make a minor correction here. If you say reintroduction of the Canadian gray wolf to anybody that lives in the West, they're gonna jump down your throat, because that's a non-native species that's been introduced. It's been a forced introduction. So. Right. Colorado, I attended a Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation seminar while I was at the SHOT Show and made some good contacts. We're going to talk to the guys that are working to fight this off, but it is a ballot measure in Colorado, but it has not been carried through yet. So some of the stakeholders there are, of course, Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation. You've got the Western Slope Cattle Ranchers. You've got Colorado Farm Bureau, who is working with the ag community to fight this thing. So it is not a done deal yet, but they want to introduce 1,000 Canadian grays to the ecosystem in Colorado. Now think about this. Since 1990, the state of Colorado has had a huge push on the towards the rehabilitation of the moose. Mm-hmm. The moose in Colorado, and they've seen huge dividends paying off on all that management work for the last 20 some years. In the Swan Valley of Montana, you cannot find a moose. I'm sure they're there, but it's nothing like it used to be. And moose are easy prey for a pack of wolves in the deep snow. They will absolutely wipe them out. So you just take one animal that Colorado, the hunters in Colorado have been putting money through Pittman Robertson funds, all these hunters from back east that go to Colorado to buy license, all that money has been put to work to restore a struggling moose population. And now you've got the Chaco sandal wearing metrosexuals from Boulder and Denver that think putting a wolf back on that landscape is a good idea. And they've pushed it to the point now where it's a ballot issue where the general public can vote on this. And you know what happens when that starts? You get all the infomercials that are misinformation, if not outright lies, to tell people that the wolf should live there, and it will help with all these things, and wolves change rivers and all this other garbage that you hear about the gray wolf. And you're gonna piss away millions of dollars of research just for the moose. Okay, so the elk aren't even at their goals. This is the thing. There are wildlife professionals, biologists that do nothing but track this data, restore this data, study this stuff, and then you get this emotional push from the left to put a wolf in the middle of all that. When the professionals are sitting over here saying, hey, our data doesn't support this. And to further exasperate the problem is the fact that by legislation, the professionals in Colorado Fish and Game and Parks are not allowed to come out and voice their opinions publicly about why this is a bad idea.
Well, you know, and that's pretty much it. And it's all over. I know when the last day that we were in Arizona, in New Mexico, we flew into Albuquerque. Lauren and I went to the Museum of Anthropology there at the University of New Mexico campus in Albuquerque. And what did we see there were these posters all over the place about supporting our monument, the Mexicans, our New Mexicans speak out for national monuments, and they want to make this wolf a national monument there. and sticker bumper stickers, Wolves Belong, and you know, and all of this, and it's on college campuses is where we're seeing a lot of this. You know, there was a poster that the Mexican wolf, the people and the land are intertwined, you know, and this Disney philosophy that the wolf can coexist is absurd, and yet
it's embraced.
It's embraced by those that are ignorant of the facts.
It's ballot box biology. It's you know, where anybody with an emotional opinion can vote on that, and you know, I'm not a marathon runner. So the Boston Marathon doesn't mean anything to me. I have no stake in the Boston Marathon. So why should I get a vote on how the Boston Marathon is run? Yeah, that's my, it's the same thing. And the Mexican wolf isn't anything compared to this Canadian gray wolf. This Canadian, the Mexican,
not in size,
not in ferocity. We hunted among the Mexican wolves down in the White Mountains when I was out there with Sonny Tappy and Sportsman for Heroes. And we hunted there. Those Mexican wolves are in the mountains, but you talk about the Canadian gray, that dude is nothing but a career killer. And I talked to one houndsman that's lost 30 hounds since 95 or 96. Actually, I talked to a friend of his that he was telling me about that. He's lost 30 hounds estimated in that time period. You know, obviously it would be easiest to say, well, you shouldn't turn your dogs loose where the wolves are. But here's the real scoop on that. Okay, you find a lion track, you do your due diligence to run the trails all around. You find the track, and then you run around and you try to find wolf tracks to see if it's safe to turn your dogs loose. You know, what if the wolf, and we're talking about in sections of trails where there's gate closures, we're talking thousands of acres of timbered land. If that wolf pack spent the night down below there and you got a snow on it that night, you're never going to see that wolf track. And you're going to turn your dogs loose in there, and within minutes, you'll be recovering collars, bells, and tracking collars. That's all you're going to have left. And I've heard stories like that coming out of the West for years, and it really hit home for me on this particular hunt because we did not turn loose on a lot of lion tracks because of these wolf tracks. And I'm talking fresh stuff. You know, we had a lion track. It's beautiful. A male and a female, Tom and a female walking down this trail. They were doing their little love frolicking and playing, and you could see where they rolled around in the snow and stuff. We go up the trail, and there's five wolf tracks. And I took my hat off, and I put it beside one of these tracks to give some perspective. That wolf track was as big as the round part of my hat. That's a freak. That's a freak of nature, and the only thing he's built for is to kill.
Well, why do you think that the wolf was nearly eradicated in the West? Was it because their pelts were so valuable?
No. History doesn't speak to that.
Not at all. You know, not at all.
If you read, what book was it about the... I can't remember but it was about a wolf hunter. I read a book one time about a wolf hunter, and it talked about the hard work that went in to eradicate the wolf from the Western landscape. And my deep down feeling, Steve, is that this is a flanking maneuver from the liberal left, the animal extremists, animal terrorists that want to fight against our way of life, to reintroduce this predator on the landscape that they know is not supposed to be there, but it's to defund wildlife agencies, drive down the purchase and sale of license in these Western states, affect these economies until there is no hunting opportunity left. And you can see that in the West, you can see that in the Swan Valley. Anybody you talk to, if you talk to any lifelong resident of the Swan Valley, they'll talk about the Shiras moose walking along this Flathead River there, the river system there, and they could sit on their porches at night and hear the moose down there in the river, you know, grunting, fighting, antlers clashing. That's gone, completely gone. You know, people that are lifelong residents talk about, you know, how hazardous it was to even drive down the Swan Highway between Kalispell and Sealy Lake, because around every corner, you know, there's going to be a moose standing in the road, or there's going to be deer standing in the road, or there's going to be elk standing in the road. I can tell you just from last year that the numbers have gone down. I saw it last year. I was amazed when I got in the Swan Valley. I'm like, holy crap, there's deer everywhere here. You know, of course, the snowpack had moved them down. But even the deer tracks up on the mountains where they should have been still were completely down. And also the elk sign was way down. We found one herd of about 20 cows. And that's all we saw of elk the whole time I was there.
Well, and, you know, we hear a lot about fake news today. But you hear these so-called experts on the wolf talk about the success of the introduction of wolves to Yellowstone. What a great success that was, and how that they have positively impacted the ecosystem in Yellowstone and all, without one word about the disappearance of the deer and elk and all that are the victims daily of these elk, of these wolf packs. So, you know, you're not going to get the straight of it in the media or in the news.
Not at all. So let me relate a story to you. I talked to a guy that works construction while I was out there, and they were doing some work inside of Yellowstone. So they, as far as that is, they would go in there and stay in one of the lodges, and they were remodeling some buildings in there. He grew up there. When he was a kid, you know, people could go in there and you could see the elk herds and the deer, mule deer herds and all these ungulate populations on the landscape, mountain lions. And believe me, these wolves will eat a mountain lion too. The mountain lions aren't happy with them either. So they're affecting that part of our sport. But, okay, so now Yellowstone, the only thing you can go in Yellowstone and see now are buffalo. And the wolves will eat a few buffalo, but those buffalo cows are good about putting the calves in the center and horns out and come and get it type attitude, and the wolves are smart enough not to try it. So what's happened is they've depleted that resource, and they're just spreading out. Even when they did that introduction back in 95, 96, I can't remember, you know, in the wildlife profession as a conservation officer, you know, you would think that I would be like, oh, you got to protect the wolf. My stance has always been, that's fine. You want to drop them on the Yellowstone National Park. Once they cross that boundary, it's open season. And the left fights that with injunctions. The western states are trying to manage their wolf population. Every time they turn around, they're getting held up on something with injunctions through the federal court. I mean, it's a mess. It's a mess.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. And that's the aim. You know, if we can get everything tied up in court and drag it out over years and years, people will just get tired of fighting the battle and give up, right. You know, and that's a strategy, I believe.
Yep.
And a lot of issues. But yeah, well, the wolf for sure. How devastating to a hounds person that has put his sweat and blood and many years into a breeding program, and then not be able to let those dogs do what they were bred to do simply because of the feel good policies of these social justice warriors that are so prevalent today. You know, everything is based on feeling. You know, it's not two and two and two. Is it four? Well, how do you feel about it being four? You know,
yeah,
that's
exactly
the kind of thinking. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
There's no basis of reason there at all. And until it comes home, I remember when we had the fight in 1997, I believe it was, in Michigan. We talked about it with Mike Thorman on this podcast, bear issue in Michigan, you know. And it wasn't until we were able to build some commercials that showed children that had been attacked, you know, by bear in areas, that some of the people begin to see there really does need to be a season on bears. We can't let them be overpopulated. We can't have them running in the streets and in our backyards, you know. So maybe, you know, I don't know. It may be too late for that sort of thing, but I know that we have to fight it every step of the way. If we hope to have any kind of opportunity to hunt with hounds in the West, this wolf issue is going to have to be dealt with.
Oh, it's happening in the East too, though. You look at the UP of Michigan. At Wisconsin. You know, so it's affecting Maine. You look at all these places. It's coming to a neighborhood near you, and houndsmen, regardless if you're a beagler, if you're a coyote hunter in the East, you've got to be paying attention. And that's always been our goal with this podcast, is to broaden the scope of people's vision, you know. And I can't help but think and believe with every fiber that this is nothing more than another attack by the liberal left to eliminate hunting on a broad scale. And, you know, deer hunters need to be paying attention. And Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation is leading the charge in Colorado. So they're on board. But we need to support these fights. And we need to be aware of what they are, be able to talk intelligently about it, and then render whatever support we can give them. I don't care if you're turning a coon dog loose in Ohio or a coursing dog loose in southern New Mexico. This is an attack, and we've got to realize what it is.
And as I'm thinking as you're talking, Chris, that it also is important that we take this these animal terrorists on at every level. You know, it doesn't matter. It may not be wolves here in Florida that we're dealing with, you know, but we need to take them on when these organizations come out with these anti-tethering bills, or these bills that say you can't leave a dog outside unless it's supervised. And all of these attempts by these terrorists to take away our lifestyle have to be met head on with an organized effort. You have to get involved. You know, here in Florida, I know our friend Bruce Conkey is trying through his American Houndsman Federation to fight the fight here in the Southeast. But wherever the enemy is, you know, we have to take them on. We have to be organized. We have to say, no, this is not reasonable. And, you know, the wildlife overall is what's going to suffer from this. And you cite that wildlife conservation model, which, you know, really did turn things around in this country. But, you know, if given the whims of these feel-good anti-hunters, you know, wildlife is going to be in deep, deep trouble here in this country. I really believe that.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. And it's time that people need to be finding out. If you're in the Southeast, you need to find out about Bruce Conkey's organization down there and get involved. Get involved. The Hoosier Tree Dog Alliance is going to have a banquet here. Get involved. Once it happens, it is too late. We cannot be reactive anymore to this sort of stuff. Right now, so this morning on social media, I posted a house file, they call that a house file in the state of Iowa, that makes it a misdemeanor for a person pursuing fur bears for the purpose of taking fur bears or training dogs to chase fur bears. It makes it a misdemeanor for you to allow your dog to enter private property without first gaining permission. You're tracking? What I'm saying, if you allow your dog to cross this fence and go onto private property, you can be charged with a misdemeanor under this proposed bill right now in Iowa. It's House File 2147. And people need to, from all over, need to make their voice heard on that and say, how in the world am I going to prevent my hound from leaving this piece of property and getting over here? If I get a piece of permission to hunt one property, if this goes through, I better get permission for everything within about a 5-mile radius of where I'm turning that hound loose. So you get a farmer over here, a guy that's involved in ag, and he wants a coyote hunter to come in and help him control his predator problem. Or you get a grain farmer that's got raccoons destroying his crop, and he wants a houndsman to come in there to help him with his problem. The 3-acre parcel on the corner of this section that's owned by this farmer, you know, you got the guy living on the 3-acre section. If you don't have permission from him and your hound crosses on there, buckle up, buttercup, because you are going to, right then, you violated the law.
Yep. For sure. We fought this in Michigan, and we were successful in the fight. But these are precisely the kind of things that we have to be aware of, and we have to combat these things. You know, I'll give a shout out to my friends Joe and Nancy Hudson up in the UP of Michigan. The UP Bear Houndsman Banquet will be held in March, and I'm very honored to be on the docket of speakers up there this year, and looking forward to it. But this wolf issue is something that's very near and dear to the hearts of those people up there, because the hounds are being killed at an alarming clip by wolves in Michigan, and as you said, in Wisconsin and all across the upper Midwest. So it'll be interesting. I hope to do some recording while I'm up there, and maybe we can get some firsthand information on what's going on up there as far as dealing with the wolf issue.
Yep. And we need our listeners. That's what this podcast was designed to be, the voice for the houndsman. So the reason I'm aware of the House file in Iowa is because one of our listeners, I'm going to give him a shout out, James Mead, forwarded me the proposed bill and asked me my advice on it, asked us what we should do about it. So if you know that legislation is coming up, then notify us. We will talk about it on this podcast, and we will do the things that we need to do to orchestrate an effective countermeasure to that bill. What we can do is not nearly as valuable as what you can do right now on the ground in your home state, and that is forming these alliances among your fellow houndsmen. Stop arguing about who's going to turn what dogs loose and what color dogs you're hunting and all this other stuff, and unite. Now is the time. It's coming. It's not going to be pretty, and it's going to be too late. And reach out now and support the deer hunters. Find those ways to bridge those gaps with your deer hunters and your duck hunters and your small game hunters. Bring all those people together. Make them aware of what's happening. Because if we lose hound hunting, the guy sitting in the deer stand, we've said this before, you know, maybe the next law is, well, you're not allowed to hunt a deer from an elevated platform. Maybe you're not allowed to hunt a deer over a food plot. Maybe you're not allowed to hunt a deer with a compound bow. Who knows what it can be, but it's coming.
Oh, without a doubt, for sure. And we have to be vigilant, and everybody doing their part, as you say, Chris, that's the fundamental thing. Again, we talked about it recently on a podcast about every vote counts. You know, why do politicians go out to some farmer in the middle of Iowa and knock on his door when it's only one vote? But right. That one vote becomes one more. And that's how elections are won and lost. And, we've certainly shined the tree, as we like to say on the podcast today, Chris. But I think it's been a good discussion from my standpoint, really enjoyed the recap of your Western tour. Any other thing, interesting things that happened out there?
Oh, we just, I got on a soapbox here, but I think it's a discussion that needs to be had, but there are still tons of opportunities for houndsmen all across our country. And I would just encourage people to go try new things and experience new places to hunt, get to know houndsmen from other parts of the country that I'm telling you right now that the guys in the West have no idea what it's like to be in a night hunt. You know, 99% of them they've only heard what it is. And so they're as interested about what we're doing here with our hounds as we are about what they're doing with their hounds. But there is no divide here. The common thread is the love of this lifestyle of being a houndsman and hearing those dogs work out that track, come treed, you know, bringing that rabbit around to the gun, whatever it is, there's a common thread there. And I just encourage people to go experience that. Take some vacation time and go see what's going on out there in the big bad world.
Well said. You know, I just had this conversation with one of our former guests, Randy Smith, just today about he just returned from his annual trapping trip to Louisiana and talking about the very abundant raccoon population there and the availability of land to hunt and so forth. So it may entail getting out of the backyard and doing a little traveling as we've done in the last month, and especially you, Chris.
But you've been on the road a bunch too.
Oh, well, yeah, I really have. And I honestly, my exploits haven't been a whole lot more successful than yours this year. I started off, back in the fall, and we did go to Arkansas, which was hampered by the water this year again. That's getting to be a problem out there. But we had 7 or 8 great days in camp, ate lots of food, told lots of stories, and had a wonderful time. And of course, we did have a very successful bear hunt in Virginia, 3 and 5 bears in 5 days. So that was a lot of fun. But anyway, yeah, did a lot of traveling, and I'm looking forward to doing some more. Nubbin and I have a trip up in Alabama, 3 or 4 day trip that we're going to go and try a new spot. And
so you got your kitchen pass renewed.
I did. You know, I might have told you or the listeners that Miss Ella told me the last time. She said, "I don't mind you doing all this traveling this winter. That's great. But before you plan any more trips, how about let's have a talk about it?" you have any idea what she was getting at there?
I kind of got the same response last night. It's like, hey, I'm glad you're home, but I'm going to tell you 4 weeks was too long. I didn't even know she liked me that much.
That's right.
You know,
that's
so. Right.
Well, we do. That's a good way to tell, but it's a risky way, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's right. Well, I think we've pretty well covered the better part of an hour or so here, Chris. I'm not sure, but.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yep. So. I'm glad that we got to share the experience. Shout out to everybody that was hosting along the way. Calvin Redhouse, Jared Moss of Best Gun Dogs and in Beaver, Utah. Anthony Pace, big shout out to him and Freedom Hunters. Yep. You know, not only was he a great host on the reservation, but after we got to Las Vegas, I'm going to tell you, Anthony's a mover and a shaker. That guy, he gets out and works hard for Americans veterans and makes sure that there's opportunities out there. He was in meetings doing radio shows. He was working his tail off at the SHOT Show. And I can't stress enough to our listeners what a great organization that is. I interacted with some of the veterans that have been involved with Freedom Hunters there. Great guys, and just a great organization. His family was there. And then Kevin and Nancy Hall up in Pocatello, Idaho. And then Jamie Anderson is one of the best cooks that I've ever eaten her food. I mean, she's an outstanding cook. We had huckleberry pie. We had they pick the huckleberries up there and freeze them. And we had breakfast burritos. And she's fun to be in the mountains with. Her and Larry both are fun to be in the mountains with. But so shout out to everybody that took me under their wing and took care of me the last 4 weeks.
Well, they did a good job, and I'll echo that as well. It's good to see you made it safely back home. And another person I'd like to briefly give a shout out to, Chris, is our buddy, the big guy, Mark Zapp. Mark has been a supporter of this podcast since the very start. Not out front type thing, but he's been there with products and things that we've used in our drawings and our promotions. And so I just want to give a shout out to my big buddy there, Mark. He's at MarkZepp.com. And of course, he builds predator calls, coon squallers. He has a new line of dog boxes, as his clothing and all. But Mark's just a great guy that's been very supportive of us, and I just wanted to give him a brief shout out
there. And he's never asked for a thing. You know, that's the thing.
You see
Mark. There are going to be some good things coming in the near future, and Mark was instrumental in opening some doors for us with this podcast. So I will echo and amplify what you said about Mark Zepp. You know, he's been behind the scenes, been happy to be behind the scenes, but he's been a huge supporter.
For sure, for sure. Well, is it about time to turn them loose, Chris?
It is.
All right. Well, as we've said many, many times on this podcast, if you're a houndsman, you know what I'm talking about. When we cut loose on this track, you follow your hound, I'll follow mine.